All right, we look pretty filled up, and I don't know if there's a GCAP official, but it's 5 o'clock, so I'm going to get running anyway. Hello, I'm Ryan Keable. I work for Mighty Games. I started working at Mighty Games in April last year, where I was brought on to work on Disney Crossy Road, but I eventually shoehorned myself into the Shooty Skies team simply because I like to make things go boom, which is what we're going to be talking about today. Yay. So, first of all, I'm running Unity in runtime here to show particles off to you guys. We did this yesterday for Unite, and I had a couple of little bugs with the Unity game window going blank. So I've upgraded Unity, and hopefully we won't have that issue as much today, if at all. So what are we talking about today? Well, obviously we're going to be talking about particle effects. And when I first started approaching this talk, I kind of kept trying to come up with all these ways to encompass everything about particle effects, talking about all the different principles, all the different properties. And I actually had a lot of trouble trying to develop a structure that way, and originally thought of trying to go through, you know, the different elements like fire, water, gas, wind, magic, arcane, et cetera, et cetera. But as I kept trying to bunch everything together, I found you can't really bunch everything together. Particles, in essence, are a really fluid system. They can be used to represent almost everything from things that are ethereal to things that are pretty much also physical and have physical properties. So with that in regard, I end up taking a step back and going, okay, how about I just run through the steps that I take to build particle effects the way I build them? So this is going to be a pretty technical presentation. We're going to be talking about how I set things up, how I add behavior, which to me is the most key element to making cool particle effects. I get really focused on behavior more than anything else. And then I'm going to be talking about adding the final tweaks, those little things that really make them pop and make them effective. And over the course of it, we're going to be looking at particle systems in my little scene here, and we're going to do a few case studies to go in a little bit of depth with them. It's important to note that my approach is really stylistic and cartoony. So what may work for me may not work for you. And one of the really ultimate rules of anything that we do is there is no size fits all. There is not one rule for everything. So if you have different ways of approaching things, go for your life. If they work for you, they work for you. As far as concepts go, we're going to be looking pretty strongly, like I said, at behavior. And for me, that behavior is derived by shape, color and light, and the animation of a particle effect. So what are particle effects? Like I was saying before, particle effects, pretty hard to define in terms of what they actually are. This was the best I could find on Google, which is particle effects replicate elemental and magical phenomena. Mostly, you can also represent physical attributes and physical things flying out of whatever. Essentially, we're just dealing with something that pushes objects and particles out and en masse. But that's not always true, because we could always just be dealing with one or two objects. Like I said, it's really hard to define what they actually are. So what's really important, though, is what we use particle systems for. And there's really three key things here, and that is providing feedback for whatever's happening in the game world. So if something's being hit, something's being thrown about, we want to draw attention to that. And we really also want to support the narrative. And you also want to support it in a way that represents the rest of the stuff that's going on. So, you know, you've got a fire in a fireplace, you've got a gun flash coming out of a gun, you've got water splashes hitting rocks in a moving creek, things like that. And you can go a lot further with this as well to basically express narrative too in a scene where there isn't any. Think of, if anyone here was here for Dan Graff's talk yesterday, when all those customers entered the zoo, they had these lovely little bits of confetti flying down. Now, that just sort of extends that narrative there, saying, hey, this is a celebration. People are entering the zoo. We're open. It's really cool. Those are the kind of things that you can also take and do with particle effects. To me, what I think of when I think really cool particle effects, if anyone's seen the new Zelda videos that are coming out, I want to play that game simply just to look at the effects. They're amazing. They have amazing fluid motions, they have amazing shapes, they deal with color and light beautifully, and I don't know what kind of shaders they're using, but I want them. Bastion was also really awesome. They had so much cool animation going on their particles, and it was really fluid and really simple too. We're talking about really basic little pushes and pulses and things like that here, but that worked in total and whole and matched the tone and feel of the game. I also love all the effects from Hearthstone, but God, if you've got a team like Blizzard behind you, you're going to have amazing particle effects. So that brings us to the next point. Also, I'd just like to say I do really well with conversation format. So if people have questions anywhere along the way, feel free to raise your hand and just ask. I really prefer that. So the first thing I start to do when I'm working with particle effects, and like anybody should do with anything, is concepts. So when you're thinking about concepting, what we're really thinking about is what we're trying to create and represent. So is it a huge big explosion? Is it a small little pulsating flash? Is it a UI tooltip flash going off? Say, hey, click on me. All those kind of things. Have a think about, first and foremost, what am I trying to replicate? What am I trying to represent? Then start to think about, okay, this is what I've got to do. What are its properties? All right. What is its size and intensity? How does it behave? What kind of colors should I be using? Think of the timing. Think of what the beginning, the middle, and the end is. And as you're going through that, start to think about, again, what your shape and your color and, like I said, behavior as well, but also shape, sorry. And for some really awesome reference material to get you guys going, I looked at a lot of reference material for a lot of effects here and there. Some really good ones on YouTube are the slow-mo guys, because they just slow everything down to, you know, fractions of a second so you can see what's happening, how everything's working. And you can use those sort of insights to be able to build your part effects really well. Backyard scientists are really good. And another way actually to get really started with particle effects and actually learning how to build them is to go to the asset store, grab down some packs that look awesome and deconstruct them, go through their components, go through the particle inspector and look at what they're doing at each single step of the stage, single stage, and work out what makes that particle work. That's exactly how I got started looking at the cartoon effects pack and another really awesome environment one that had some cool billboarded sprites that we'll get to later. I looked at them, I deconstructed them, went, that's awesome, that's awesome, that's awesome. Oh, that's how they get that to move. Oh, that's how that thing's doing that. I'm going to take those bits and use them where I want them, or I'm going to grab that effect, duplicate it, and tweak it to do the things that I want to do in particular. So then we come to the initial setup of a particle effect. And this stuff is hopefully pretty common sense-y. The first thing I look at when I'm looking at a particle is what my emission shape's going to be. This sets the foundation for everything else that you're going to do. And we're talking about, you've got a base range of shapes that you can choose from in Unity, things from boxes to edges to circles to spheres, hemispheres, and a cone. I think those are all your base options for shapes in Unity. Now, what these are doing are basically setting your trajectory and direction of your particles and what area they're going to take up. And you can play with it from there. The other thing that you can really get interested in is working with different kinds of meshes for your emitters. And there's actually a wide range of options that they're starting to open up here where you can add in a mesh, you can add in a mesh renderer, and a couple other things. And I started to work with this because I think it's really cool. And on that note, actually, when you're looking at particle effects, for me, there was two ways I went about doing it. Sometimes you've got a directive, you need to make something that matches perfectly for what your designer wants or your artist wants. Or sometimes you just want to have a look at one of the components and go, how does that work? I want to play with that. I want to chuck some things in there. And from that experimentation, you often find some really cool things, and then you can take that experimentation and throw it into, well, basically find a way to shoehorn in it to something you're working on and just make it work. Because like I said, the particle system's extremely malleable. In these examples up here, in the middle and the top right, we've got two meshes, users in the emitter one to have little sparkly bits coming out of all the faces on the body of our miter machine, and one that's essentially building the object out of particles using the mesh and the mesh and the vertex colors of the mesh to display the particles. So these examples are pretty interesting. We use the sparkly effect like that in Crossy Road a lot, and swap out the meshes depending on the characters, just to show effects that are happening on two specific characters like smoke. Because often if you put a circle or just a small sphere in the middle of an object and you want to keep using that for different characters or things, it's not always going to be the right size. And if you scale it, a sphere goes out like this. And if you've got something elongated, that, you know, the sphere is not exactly going to represent how that effect should be coming out of that shape. The other thing you need to start looking at when you're dealing with your initial setup is what your effect timeline is. How long does the emitter have? How long is the emitter's duration? Which is basically saying how long does the effect over time last for? What is the emission rate? So how fast the particles are coming out? How many of them are coming out? What are the particles' lifetime? Are we bursting all the particles out at once and killing off to that, or are we having a slow trail of them coming out? Then you also got to just basically start punching in your core field. So, like I said, your particle lifetime, your initial speeds, your initial size, and your initial flat colors. So once you get all those things going, you've at least got something to start working with, a mock-up. The other thing that I find really key at this point is to start to consider your particle shape. And traditionally, particles, as we know them, are generally built with sprites. Whether they've got alpha or not is entirely up to what you're working on. Whether or not they're highly textured or not is entirely depending on what kind of project you're working on. And there's pros and cons to sprites. They're pretty easy to layer. You can get things to balance in front of each other and build for mid and background if you're compounding effects. They can be easily animated through the texture animator sheet. And you can also use atlases to chuck in multiple varieties of animations and script it so that you can get a random array of animations that way too. They can be billboarded differently, so you can have them facing the camera, you can have them so they're always facing vertical, and you can always have them facing horizontal. And you can actually get some really interesting effects out of that. One thing that I really don't like about them, and why I turn to using mesh particles everywhere, is they kind of lack this sense of 3D depth. And for us, that and me, that has become something that's super key and super stylistic to the way that I approach particle effects. So I got super keen with using mesh shapes while developing the effects for Shooty. And there was a lot of reasons why we did that. Initially, we started off by using sprites that were basically a cube-drawn texture with three different shades of grey on the top and the two sides. But we were kind of feeling like that didn't have enough cohesion with our game world and the rest of our game art. So I thought, well, you've got this ability to chuck in a mesh. What happens if we chuck in a mesh? Like I said, experimentation leads to awesome things sometimes. So we started chucking in cube meshes and playing around with how that looked and felt. And because our technical director had basically built these really awesome lighting shaders, the cube started working really well and started showing off these awesome aspects of color and light and shape that I'd never seen before. I'm like, great, let's continue to do that. So then we started to have more fun with it by chucking in all these different random shapes, because Shooty was a game that was all about everything on the internet thrown into a shoot 'em up. So like in this example, we had fish, we had turkey drumsticks, we had rabid bunny heads and anything else you could think of. We were firing these things out of any kind of effect just to illustrate the kind of crazy behavior that was going on, and also to fit the narrative of whatever the effect was coming out of at the time. So the turkey legs were coming out of, I think we had them out of our Thanksgiving bird characters that would blow up into turkey legs. The fish were just used as a background element to fire little fish in an arc from one side of the water to the other and match it with a suitable particle splash going there. Just want to show you guys quickly all the different kind of crazy meshes we end up using in a Shooty skies for particles, just so you can get an idea of the different kind of things that you guys can do. So in here we have skulls, blocks, snowflakes, a piggy bank thing that's broken apart, love heart stars, text, eyes. We started experimenting with text because it would suit the narrative of the effect and the object that was blowing up at the time. Turned out to be really effective and really funny and add gags into our game. We were using particle rings for shockwaves to keep them solid. And yeah, it was all also done to match the cubic and voxel style that had been developed through Crossy Road and followed in with Shooty Sky. So there's no end to what you can experiment there, and basically just go and have fun with it. I really like the example of the fire down in the bottom right, because fire is traditionally something you deal with that with a texture that animates, has a bit of alpha and flows across this sort of gaseous-like field. If you ever look up any basic tutorial for a fire particle effect, you'll see like five textures that are all gaseous and look like they've just been rendered clouds out of Photoshop. I thought, what happens if you chuck a mesh in there? And now we've got this nice textural object that feels 3D, still looks like fire, but is really stylistic and, would sell the style for your game if that's the kind of direction you wanted to go in. So there are a few pros and cons of meshes. One, like I keep saying, stylistic. Super stylistic. You can do anything with them if it suits your needs and purposes. Oh, go away, Doc. they're solid. They are 3D. They fit nicely in the 3D world. They help you build these nice, big, solid effects. They're affected by light, which is really awesome, especially if you have a lot of dynamic light going in your game. And actually, it makes the color on your particle effects really variant because you get automatically at least three shades of color depending on how you rotate the particle effect to display towards the camera. The only problem I found so far is it's pretty difficult to animate them. You can only just chuck in a mesh that it tends to read out of your project. I haven't actually experimented with chucking in anything like a skinned mesh and seeing if that would actually work. Could be possible. I have no idea. I'm going to try to find that out one day. And if not, I'm going to try to find a way to see if I can make that work. The other thing I like to start thinking about once I got my particle shape in place is what is the structure of the effect. So once the effect's in motion and everything, and we've got a mock-up and going back to the concept of how I want to look, what kind of structure is it going to take up? And effects basically create structure over their lifetime. Once you start adding in velocity and speed and, basically it's a combination of velocity, lifetime, and your density. For me, I find this works really well with mesh particles. So you can see in the middle there, we've got this nice geyser of water that's shooting up in a vertical column. And it looks nice and solid because it's quite dense, but actually there's not too many particles going on there. It's just 3D particles and they're solid and they make a lot of density happening in there. Up in the top right, we've got all this sort of electric energy and it's moving around and it's not necessarily building a structure, but it's showing what kind of an area the structure of the particle effect takes up. And those are the kind of things you need to think about. Also, if you're placing them in your game world and think about what space they're taking up in your game world and if it's relevant for where it's going to be. So these water spouts are from a level in Disney Crossy Road. I think it's just been launched, one of our updates, and they have a lot of freedom to move. Whereas if you're doing that and you're overtaking important elements of your game world or things that you wanted the user to see just because you look cool, that's probably a bad idea. Like if it was just coming out of a creek for no reason and blocking something that the user needs to see, you kind of got to rein it in sometimes, as I get told a lot. The other example in the bottom right is what sort of cool effects you can build by using billboarded shapes. That's essentially a whole ring of a whole amount of circle shapes being pushed up on vertical billboarding, and as they change size over time, they just build this nice looking structure. And you can play around. Like this is what I'm saying, it's very malleable and you can do lots of different things. Section 2. So far, does anybody have any questions? Are we cool to move on? Yes?
Do you think that using mostly just the parameters that the Shuriken
policy, or do you go into the code side? I sometimes go into code. It depends what I do. Most of it you can set up with Shuriken pretty well. I get the scripting a little bit in the end, so I'll follow up that question later. So the next big step, once you've got a mock-up now, is starting to give things the juice. As I like to call it, and we like to call it around the office, this is just making things look a little bit more awesome, making them really effective, making them pop, and making them feel like they're alive and have a bit more life. So the way we go about doing that, and the way I like to think of it, is the most important thing to giving something a little bit of juice and pop is thinking about giving it behavior. And we want to give it behavior that reflects what that effect is. So if you've got a gun flash, you want a nice bright flash. That's its behavior. How do we create that behavior? How do we make that flash awesome? If we've got a fire, how do we make it billow? How do we make sure that it's not consistent over time? How do we make sure it's changing and feel like it has its own life? If we have stars just popping out of a UI tooltip, how do we make that feel inviting? How do we make that feel like it's something that the user wants to click on? And in order to do that, what I found as I was writing this talk is, hey, actually, I use a lot of animation principles. Even though I didn't know it, I was using them as I started to look through, is animation something I should be talking about? And the main ones I found that I was using was squash and stretch, which is basically just popping the size over lifetime. You don't necessarily have to squash the width and the width or the height of it at different appropriate times. You just want to give it a little bit of bounce. You definitely want to set up a bit of anticipation for a lot of effects. And again, it's always dependent on what you're working on. Arcs are really nice, so having a nice flowing arc rather than just straight velocities and straight vectors. And you want to also think about timing. Timing is also super important because it's how you got to think about everything in an in a particle effect as happening over time. So where things happen at the beginning, where things happen in the middle, where things happen in the end, what's happening to that particle as it traverses that's its timeline, what's happening to its emitter as it's traversing its timeline. How do we layer in different things over time? Should things be happening at the same time or should things be snapping? Should things be blending? Timing is super important. And for us dealing with stuff that is cartoony and stylistic, exaggeration is probably your best friend. Make things feel a bit bigger than life. Make things feel like they're dominating. Make things, you know, feel like their behavior is further than it actually is. That work has worked time immemorial for cartoons. It works really well for animation, animated particles as well. The other aspect that I found that was really an important principle and is especially important to particles is variety. So variety is basically making sure that nothing's consistent. You have a lot of difference in things and that just builds more interest. Make sure things aren't consistent all the time. However, it is also important if you want something to be consistent, force it to be consistent. There were effects that we had with Shooty Skies and even in Disney Crossy Road, we would have cannon smoke and it would be blowing out a ring of smoke. So it looked that nice cartoony effect, you know, like ring of smoke coming out of a cannon. I made sure that all those effects were basically never changing in their variety and their speed was consistent, their size was consistent, so we could get a nice little visual ring and it was readable. So you got to think about in terms of what you want. Yes? Yeah, it's pretty much coming down with a little bit of gravity. As it comes down, it loses size and pops bigger as it grows, loses energy, so it shrinks again, and then just goes off into a nice little animation.
How did you add multiple sort of curves?
Well, we're going to get into that. I'm going to start opening things up. I'm going to start looking. Actually, if you want, we can start with this one. It doesn't make a difference to me. I just have to find it quickly. Section 2, intro. Okay. So we're kind of going to jump ahead a little bit, but you know, if we've got, I'll be able to come back and explain a lot of this in a little bit more detail. So for the most part, the emitter stays the same here. We have a little bit of gravity, which is what's telling it to basically come down over time. And that's what's giving it the arc. So we can switch that back and now we can get that nice little bounce back. The emission's just pretty standard. There's nothing changing with that. We have a tiny bit of vertical velocity going on to pump it up further after it comes back down. So that's giving us our vertical bounce afterwards. And there's just an extra little dip in there to basically build that little anticipation of the higher jump. So that's just amplifying the gravity to just go whoop. And that just gives a little bit more pop and makes things a little bit more interesting. And finally, we slow it down by limiting the velocity over time. And this is one of my favorite fields. And we're gonna get that into that a little bit more next. Size, again, just a little bit of a dip and a growth at the very end. And the texture sheet has another little curve where we just basically play the animation at the very end over, you know, a set amount of time. So that's the sort of stuff that you can start to work with to really give your effects a bit of life and interest. No, it's all one texture sheet. Because it's a texture sheet of an animated ball. It's just basically gone circle to, and then I hollow it out and make the hollow bigger until it's a finite ring at the end. I wish it was showing it well there in the shader material, but I'm not game enough to go find it in the project right now and lose everything that I've got up. But we might come back to that later. How do we apply animation? Basically, you just want to maximize the use of your components. You want to add ranges and you want to add curves. Those are really how we start to get a lot of animation into things and make things super interesting, as we just went through. The first thing I always start to do when I'm starting to work on an effect, after I've got that base, all the base fields filled out, actually as I'm writing in the base fields, I start to add variety between the ranges. So rather than just having a speed of one, I have a speed of 1 to 3. rather than just having a lifetime of two, I have this lifetime of between two and four, for example. I've also found at this point, it's kind of important to make sure that you go, okay, what's my expected middle mark? If your middle mark's three, don't push things between three and five because they'll always be a bit longer. Because the range, as you think about it as a range, it's always going to be basically in the 25 to 70% range, you're going to see more of that because that's 50% of your range. So things always going to be close to that middle mark. So yeah, apply that into how you deal with ranges. Also, I just want to go back and make a quick point in dealing with setup and speed and thinking of your timelines. There was a question yesterday that I answered at the end that I wanted to make a point of earlier in this one, which was when you're thinking about things and the amount of energy that they have and how you want to represent that energy, if something has a lot of energy, you want to give it a high amount of speed and a low lifetime. Whereas if something has less energy, you want to give it a lot of lifetime but less speed. And that will help you decide, work out how to keep it within the boundaries and the structure that you want to develop. Where am I up to now? So, yeah, the other things you can... The main components I adjust over the lifetime of the particle. And that's actually a key point. Right, we're dealing with right now is the lifetime of the particle and nothing else. So this is how each individual particle lives from start to its finish. The main things I change are size over lifetime. I often change the rotation over lifetime. And sometimes I change the velocity over lifetime. Velocity over lifetime is a bit difficult because, as I was saying before, your shape, emitter shape, determines the basic velocity and vector that the particle is going to travel in. And you set the speed of that speed it takes from that normal of the shape, actually. Each shape has a whole bunch of faces and normals pointing out from each of those faces. These particles fly off on those normals on particular vectors. You give a particle speed, it's flying off on that vector. As soon as you start dealing with velocity over lifetime, you're actually changing the vector that it's moving on because the velocity and force only operate on the X, Y, and Z, which can be difficult sometimes. So if you want something to come in and have sideways movement that's basically affecting your particle, then it's really good. But if you want to change the speed on its original trajectory, you've only really got one option in Shuriken, which is to limit the velocity, which is actually a really awesome tool. I love using this tool. It took me a long time to learn how to use it effectively because a lot of the times you just basically put in a gate and it hits that gate and it stops. But it's really effective and it's actually really simple. The easiest way to use it is to just play with a dampen. So actually I'm going to go back to that and we're going to go take a look at a couple of these fires. I'm going to take that fire in the bottom left and hopefully make it look like the fire in the bottom right, in the middle, by adding in a lot of these ranges. So I have trouble getting ahead of myself. So at the moment we've got two consistent speeds, 1 to 1.5. So like I'm saying, that's my middle range. So I want it to be about between that, so I'm going to go between 1 and 2. Now it's starting to have a different shape and a different feel. And the structure is starting to change and it's starting to dissipate over time. And it's like fire a little. We can start to see how the embers, some embers of the fire are going up higher and some are staying shorter. We can also start to affect the size of each particle. So now some embers are bigger, some embers are smaller. At the moment we have some color changes in there, so I'm just going to leave that. And the other thing we can do is add a touch of force over time to start to get that wind across right there. And then limiting, what I love to do with that, so that's the first thing you get out when you start to limit things, and that's what it ends up if you have zero. But your dampen basically controls how fast it gets to that point. So I used to play around with trying to control the speed, but as soon as you change the speed up above, the gate needs to change. Forget about that. That's too much of a pain. Just start to add in how quick it gets to that dampen point. And this is really cool. This is super effective. Sorry, I'll get to your question in a second. This is super effective for when you've got something that's explosive. So imagine you've got a fireball that's about to burst out from an explosion. It goes boom. Right? As soon as all that explosive force is lost, you want it to slow down and linger there on screen to make it feel like it's resonating and were super impactful. So you just add a little bit of limited velocity on that, it's going to stick around. It still has that huge explosive point at the start, but you don't need to kill it off when it still has maximum velocity. You can keep it nice and lingering on screen. Yes, there's a question down front.
What's your question next? So the first one was, when are you using two values like at the start of size of a lifetime rather?
Yep.
Or what do you get start speed as the two values?
I never know, change the lifetime, but you can change
one
the lifetime
goes
too.
To two potentially, right? So yep. Do you prefer to use values instead of a curve or a curve? Or what's the, like, why would you use a curve over values?
You want to use a curve when you want to change how the emitter works over life, which I'll get to in another point in another slide. But values are also easier input than a curve. And you can spend a lot of time trying to fiddle with a curve, try to get it right. But for the most part, you aren't really building feature effects. You're building basic effects just to suit what's going on in the game world. Every now and then, you're going to spend time on a feature effect, like a huge explosion when the boss dies, or some magical warp effect when you want to basically travel from A to B and something special that's happening off the narrative. If it's a key moment in your game story or game moment, represent it with something worthwhile. If it's something that's always happening in the background, just represent it with something simple. If you're doing something simple, keep it simple. Otherwise, you're going to spend way too much time doing things you don't need to do.
The final point I want to make on applying animation is, as soon as you start to give things good animative behavior, you can actually illustrate what the effect is really easily without supporting anything else. So in that top right example, we got basically what looks like simple fireworks. And that's displayed simply through getting the behavior correct. So by having things spring out, lose their energy over time, and leave a trail behind. Now, with that kind of notion in mind, you can now start to chuck in what abstraction into that. And this is where I found we had a lot of room to use particle meshes for particles, is because we were building correct behaviors, we could change the shape into whatever we wanted, and it would still represent to some degree of what I wanted because we had A and B, and we could replace C. So think about things that way. Abstraction is something I love to work with and makes things super interesting, and is one of the ways you can lend a lot of style to your game. The next thing to think about is animating color. And what you really need to do here also is keep in mind basic color theory. So if you've got you want to make sure that your colors are complementary when they need to be. You want to make sure your colors are contrasting when they need to be. You want to make sure you're definitely matching your game art and whatever your art director is after, or if you're the art director, make sure it matches everything else you're doing. So we actually had a bit of trouble in Shooty Skies because we had so many varying environments of different colors and sort of different tone levels on a grayscale. Trying to get things to show up correctly on every background was a bit of a headache. I think we spent a good couple of weeks arguing about the right way to draw and render and color bullets because they weren't popping on every background. So you want to really make sure that these effects are working with the rest of your game world. The other cool thing you can start to do by changing the color is you can essentially change the property of what your effect is. And, you know, the two easiest and best examples of this are taking fire and turning it into smoke by going from red to brownish black, or water into ice by going from a nice rich blue to a very light turquoise blue. And, you know, that way you can illustrate, hey, this has now changed the behavior. And you can support that with other things. So if you take water into ice, for example, well, the water could be quite fast flowing. And as you're reaching the point where you want to change the color, you can slow that the movement of that water down by limiting its velocity and having it come to a point where it freezes. And as it freezes, it changes color and tenses up. And, you know, okay, wow, we've just represented something that's changed from water to ice in pretty simple manners. So the way you end up changing color over lifetime is to use a lot of gradient colors. And I probably spend way too much time playing with gradient colors. This one is operating two different kinds of gradients. We've got some changes to the start color and some changes to the particles over time. So I'll talk a bit more about changing start color in the next direction, but I just want to touch on it here. So this is how we start to affect how the particle works over its actual lifetime. So in this instance, we're basically forcing in two different varieties of color. We're forcing in an orange and a white, followed by a deeper orange and a lighter orange. So there's always a range there between two colors, light orange and white, deep orange and orange, light orange and white, deep orange and orange. So as it goes through that, it's then being amplified by the changes in the particle over lifetime, and as it's white, it's going to stick to whatever the start color is. And then we hit points where we darken it and go light again and then darken it. And this is basically trying to show you that the particle's gaining and losing energy over time and just also giving it a lot of variety. In this instance, also, just for fun, I switched it over to cube meshes. What we're starting to get out of that, as opposed to the previous slide, is here we've just got one flat color. And it's really cool because it's sort of building this body together. But in this instance, we can start to see all those different sizes of that particle coming to make a lot of variance in the fire. I'm not saying either one's correct. I'm just trying to illustrate the nice differences you can achieve by using sprite meshes as opposed to sprite particles as opposed to mesh particles. Yes?
I have one bit about that. When you do color over lifetime, does it sort of add to the base color level?
Yes, it's basically multiplying. So you're taking where it's white and white, we've actually got white. Where it's orange and deep orange is going further into orange. Or finding a range between whatever that orange is and whatever this orange is.
Best example is if I actually kill off the range and you can see it there. So at the start, it's pretty much pure orange, and then there's flashes of white. At the start of the life cycle, it's quite hot and white. And then it follows through to be more orange and then white and more orange and then white. And you can see them start to multiply together. Is there anything else that I wanted to talk about with color? Yes, so you can also, like I was saying with ice, illustrate how you can have energy change over time by going from, bright to dull is an easy way to represent something losing energy. Dull to bright is an easy way of showing something gaining a lot of energy. We also use as just a simple thing all the time, having sparkles, which is basically having a point in the middle of the emitter where it goes white again. Oh, I might grab a deeper color. And pinch them together a tad bit more because this one's got a long lifetime. Now you're starting to see these nice little hot white flashes in there, which make things sparkle, which is really good for just having ambient stars sitting around circling something. As soon as you start to add some white sparkles into it, it looks really nice. The other thing that I found really useful, especially with dealing with layering things over backgrounds and sort of making sure they pop, is to always give things a white flash at the start. So in the example up in the top right, everything is white at first, and then it starts to fade off into color. And this is a nice way of grabbing something, your user's attention, to have a quick look at it. They don't have to completely pay attention to it, but hopefully you've given them enough that they're going to notice it in the corner of their eye or pay attention to it on some level. This is really effective when you have really varying degrees of color in your background too. White works on pretty much everything except for white itself. But then you can obviously change that to be black or a darker color. Again, just keep basic color theory in mind. The other really cool thing we did with color with Shooty Skies was to do these things I found they did a lot in anime, which is like negative flashes. So have black quickly flashed into white before the particle effect goes into full motion. And that sort of creates this nice, what I like to think of, a polarized image that gets imprinted on the mind. Like think if you look up at bright lights and shut your eyes and you can still see those light entities on your eyelids. Kind of build that effect by flashing things black, then white, and then having the effect come out from there. End up being quite effective. All right. So now to move on to the next point I want to make, which is giving the emitter life. And this now starts to change the conversation from thinking about what the particle's doing itself over lifetime to what the emitter itself is doing over lifetime. And this now adds narrative not just to the particles, but also to the game object that the particles are coming out of. So in this example, we've taken our water spout and we've pushed it a little bit further and we've given a few more behaviors and a couple more effects. I actually think that adjusting the emitter over lifetime is an underused ability, and I think you can get a lot more interesting things out of it. But again, it really depends on what you're trying to do. In this instance, well, the first thing you want to do when you're starting to think of changing the emitter of a lifetime is now we're dealing with changing the start lifetime, the start speed, the start size, and the start rotation. And this is where we add curves to them to show that, hey, the emitter is actually changing its behavior over lifetime. So what we've got here is
First of all, we've got those few little nice bubbles that precurse or indicate that something's about to happen, and this is helping build the anticipation for the effect. They increase in the emission rate and their velocity just a tad, and then we hit a point where the geyser bursts. We've got a splash of all these water droplets followed by the column that is the water spout. And the water spout itself starts off with a lot of high energy, reaches pretty high up, and then it starts to dissipate over time. So in that instance, we've got a lifetime where everything stays pretty much roughly the same until partway through it. Now, as the emitter changes, the actual lifetime of the particles drop off and then basically sit flat towards the very end. And this is how we get that drop in lifetime. We also do drop in energy. We also add a touch of speed change to that. So actually the speed pushes up first so that the geyser looks like it shoots rather than just actually exists straight up vertically. And then the speed comes down a little bit over lifetime as well. And those are the only two curves we're applying there, just simple changes over lifetime to change that behavior. But it shows a gain in energy and a loss in energy and basically indicates that the geyser's finished doing what it's doing and doesn't come to a complete and utter harsh stop. Yes, up the back. Yes, sorry, duration, absolutely correct. Keep talking about lifetime and now I'm starting to talk about duration. Yes, when you're dealing with emitter the emitter timing, you're dealing with the duration of the emitter, which is basically dictating how long that emitter exists for. In this case, it's sitting there for 4 seconds. All right, now we go about applying the extra juice. And these are the nice little simple things that I find that we can do to really make things pop and stand out and just have a little bit of interest, and basically takes all those animation principles we've been talking about and applies them in a simple fashion that you can easily replicate across lots of effects. The first property I want to talk about there is tempo. And when I'm talking about tempo, I'm talking about sort of changing the beat up. And this refers pretty much predominantly to the emission rate. And I like to think of it in sort of a musical sense. A 4-4 beat, which is just da da da, can be pretty boring. Why not use a beat that's a little bit more interesting? Da 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 da. Have it a bit more erratic, have it a bit more inconsistent. You can indicate particular behaviors in that fashion. What I can do now is show you a curve I prepared earlier, because this one gets a little bit more intense. There we go. So now those stars are coming out in different fashions. It's inconsistent. They're popping. It's erratic. But it's a little bit more interesting. It's sort of drawing the attention a little bit more. This was something that I talked to Ed about a while ago when he was walking on Warlock Firetop Mountain. This was an example of water hitting rocks in a moving creek. He was trying to get some splash particles effects going, and I'm like, what you need to do is just, as that timeline or the emission rate's going, just dip it every now and then, choke it and then pulse it, then choke it, then pulse it, and it'll feel like at different times the water's hitting and splashing the rocks and coming off in different ways. And that worked really nicely. The next thing is adding just a little bit of bounce, just dipping the size and increasing the size over time. In a little bit of a staccato, going back to music fashion, works really well. This is super effective for doing a little bit of squash and stretch. And we saw it in that first example, and I've got it again here in this example with the smoke sprite down the bottom. Now it hits out there, it pulses, the color's in time with it, and it's just a little bit more interesting than just coming out and then down again, in and out. So that is just one simple curve. That's just up, spike, spike, less size, and then sort of plateau out, and then just shrink at the end. Really nice and simple. Chuck that in any effect, where especially with UI stuff, as it pops out, it's going to do wonders. The other thing that I found when I was working on a new game, Charmy, we're having these coin flashes come out when you bought things, and I thought it'd be really cool just to chuck a little bit of extra collision in there, so that when the coins hit anything, like when the coins fell, rather than just falling through the game world on our 2D tower, they would feel like they were hitting a surface and doing that ka-ching effect that coins do. So you look at that effect, you're probably hearing that sound that coins make to a certain degree. That's ka-ching, ka-ching, ka-ching. And that's just adding a little bit more behavior and making it feel a bit nicer. And I've timed in with that like nice little white hot flash as it comes out, and when they hit,
they also get a nice little white flash. You can't really actually force the collision to tell the color to change, unfortunately. I had to sit there and time that one out. I'll see if I can pull it up. Yeah, so there we're dealing with the collision component, sorting how much it bounces, how much we dampen the energy that it has when it bounces, and yeah, unfortunately there's no way to change the color there, but I've just tried to time in as it was hitting the bottom where I wanted to change the color. Yes, Ed?
Yeah, just a quick question. Would you, like, you would use just the collision system for that, or would you potentially do like a velocity type thing where you'd put your own bounce into the thing?
You can put your own bounce in there, but it ends up being a little bit fiddly. The velocity over lifetime works on each individual particle, and as soon as your particles have different lifetimes, they're going to bounce at different lifetimes, so things could bounce here or things could bounce here. Again, if you wanted to have the exact same lifetimes, then it could bounce all at the same point, but collisions is a nice and easy way of solving that problem. I actually had tried doing that first and then realized, oh yeah, that's not going to work. The other way you can start to get really interesting is to extend the variety further by adding ranges between your curves. And this can... there's a quick question up there.
I was just curious about, so you're talking about not being able to time the light when it hits the collision point. Is there a reason you think you just don't go into like creating additional emitters? So like you can create a coin with a separate emitter?
So what do you mean by that?
So as the coin hits the ground, would it not be easier then to create a new emitter of the coin that has that light of when it hits and springs off?
You could do it that way. I imagine it would be difficult to time. Well, you could have the collision send off a trigger to tell another particle effectively go off, but then the issue you might have there is that the coins may not be in the same place as soon as the new emitter starts playing, because it's going to randomly build them or whatever shape
You could do that if you want. You can do that for what's other different things. We'll get to some emitters in a little bit. Can you make a few effects? Yes, yeah, I feel like just actually linking to that, I think it adds an extra draw call. Yes, every single extra emitter you have, it's an extra draw call. Yeah, if you want to keep things optimized, keep your emitters low. I've gotten a lot of trouble technical work with Ben Bittersmith to keep my system, the amount of systems low, used for effects down to a minimum. Because it's really killing low end device.
So these are the fun things you learn over time when they just let you go wild and don't really monitor it well enough, and you don't really fully understand optimization straight away. So, as I was saying, you can extend the variety of your effects further by adding ranges between two curves. But this can be really extensive with the amount of time it takes to do things. So I recommend not doing that too often. So now we've got an effect that sort of puts all those ideas together, and we've got this big billowing fire that changes quite significantly over both the emitter's lifetime and the particle's each individual particle's lifetime. And now we're starting to chuck in three different curves over its lifetime that all work in unison. And what these are doing, and they're also timed into the gradient color, and what these are doing is basically telling the particle effect... also there's the emission one, and this one's rather important. So what I'm trying to do with this is replicate how fire might breathe with added oxygen over time. So at the start of the effect, we're billowing a lot of oxygen, and to indicate that, we're having this nice big white hot flash, and we increase the speed of those particles, and we increase the lifetime of those particles, so they float up nice and high and feel like they've been fueled extensively, and then we choke that off a little bit, we dampen the colours, we dampen the lifetime, we dampen the speed, then we pulse it up again and down, down, and then up, and then down. This is a pretty extensive effect. As soon as you start dealing with the amount of ranges between curves with this, you've got a lot of calculations on each single particle. So like I was saying, keep this stuff for feature stuff, or just play with it to have a really good understanding of how it works and how you can minimise it for effects that you want to do. Yes? Super, super cheap. They're just vertices, and I don't know if they optimize. They don't optimize things that you can't, like the back verts, because they need to be rotated. You used to try to chuck optimize meshes into there, and that just breaks it. It does not like that. But they're pretty goddamn cheap. You're just dealing with verts, and you're just dealing with the vertex style. Yes, Rob.
On a side note of that, can you use a sprite as a source, or do you have to then make a mesh?
that sprite.
Well, what do you mean by that?
So, I'm working on my current personal project is a 2D game, and
yeah.
so I'm using a lot of 2D Unity sprites. And to do that, replicate that effect, does the renderer doesn't support like taking one of those sprites as a source for the shape?
You can chuck an animated sprite in there.
Okay. Yeah, not animated ones.
You could just tuck any kind of sprite in there.
You mean like emitting from the vertexes? So
using the
shape of the 2D object.
Yes, rather than, like, instead of using the shape of the 3D object, using the shape of the 2D object.
Right.
So it'd be going on like the output value or something.
Oh, just like, yeah. I guess not then. No, it sounds like
no is
the right answer.
We might talk about that one a bit later because that's pretty technical and might need a few heads to solve. Anyway, so yeah, like I was saying, the breath is illustrated by the change in colour, the change in speed, and the change in lifetime, as well as the change in emission over the emitter's duration. We actually don't apply too much changes to anything else other than the size over lifetime and the colour over lifetime here. So, section three. Adding additional layers. Ooh, I've got to speed up. Sub-emitters. I don't actually use them too much, but they can be super effective. There's two ways you can use sub-emitters, either on birth, where the new emitter will attach to whatever particles are coming out of your original emitter, and we use this extensively to add trails to moving particles, which is really great for creating fireworks, or missiles. If you have a missile, you can chuck a trail on the end of that, whatever. I find it's also really important here to use emission rate over distance rather than time here. It keeps it nice and consistent to whatever object's moving at whatever speed it's moving, and the emission will change in accordance to how much that particle gains or loses speed. The other way you can deal with sub-emitters is with on-dash or collision, and now the emitter is occurring where the particle life ended or where its collision point was. And this just allows you to set up sequences like chain reactions or have reactive effects of any kind. And really, it just allows us to add more narrative to what's going on. We did this really well with the pinatas in Shooty Skies as well. They have this original explosion, and then all those additional explosions end up going into all these little pops of color and shape, and it felt ultimately like all these little candy pops were coming out everywhere. And it was really nice. This is where it got really fun for me, was actually starting to put all these things together. So this is probably my favorite effect from Shooty Skies. It was one of the ones we put in an update for the Black Friday sales. So the narrative of that update was all about the Black Friday sales in the US and shopping and sales and things like that. So I thought, hey, why not do some fun things like this? So in this example, we have all this huge text pop up like a Harvey Norman ad or one of these really gimmicky TV ads about big sales for what's going on. That is all just one particle mesh being thrown out, increasing its size rapidly and then sitting there sustaining so you can visualize it and read it before it pops off on screen. At the end of the effect, we're throwing out a few coins and this nice big cash thing. So I like to think of it like my concept for that was when you see somebody throw all this cash up into the air. You know, in a movie or something like that, it flies up and then it starts to sit there and float and gently come down. So all I did for that was put on a whole heap of explosive force, then limit the velocity, and then basically allow it to drop with a bit of gravity while rotating the meshes over time to feel like they're waving or flapping around in the wind. Really simple stuff, a lot of exaggeration, a lot of neat little tricks just to sell something to make it feel like it actually exists. As actually doing something when really it's not, which is bending and things like that. These obviously don't bend. The other cool part about this is that negative flash at the start, which I think is really cool. It just sort of illuminates and it imprints on you some this nice little impactful effect that draws your attention to it really big. So the other thing that's really important to start to think about here when you're dealing with compounding effects is timing in a different manner. This is the last little component I wanted to talk about, which is start delay. So the first thing, the original emitter goes off and then we start to delay everything else after that. So the fireball comes 0.15 of a second later, the smoke comes 0.15 of a second later, I think the cash, is that the dollars? Yeah, dollars. is 0.4 seconds later. So now we're thinking of the entire emitter existing on this lifetime. Okay, here's this happening here, here's this happening here, here's this happening here, and here's this happening here. And all we're doing is adding a little bit of delay to make sure that it sequences together nicely. The other way this works, which is really tricky and quite fun, and you can really only get away with this with a fixed camera, is because it's 3D and they're 3D meshes, and this is another con of them, they're really actually quite difficult to layer. So as soon as you've got 3D meshes emanating all together, they're going to start taking up each other's space. There's no layering system that. 5 minutes, yep. So all I did was basically force things to come out at different points along the Z value. So that pointed directly at the camera just basically forces the layers to happen, and we get this nice effect that feels like it's all together, but really it's all separated out. And I tweaked the sizes of the things in the background accordingly to make them feel like they're all in the same mid-ground area. Okay. The other thing you can do is start to add scripts. We've done this quite a bit. Basically, you want to use scripts to either extend the capabilities of Shuriken or fill gaps. The more they upgrade Unity, the less I need to fill gaps now. Now I'm just starting to do things that extend the capability. So as I was talking about earlier, one of the problems is you can't change the velocity of a particle along its original trajectory unless you want to decelerate it. And as soon as you add a gate to it in limit velocity, you can no longer open that gate again. It will never gain acceleration again, which is really annoying. But if you want to de-accelerate something from the beginning, the only way to do that is with the script. So for that effect down below, we have all these particles sitting around a ring. We inverse the speed, so it's a negative speed, so they traject inwards. And we started off at like a 0.1 speed, really slow. And then we got a script that on each fixed update, we're adding more and more speed to the particle by looking it up and going, okay, find my particle, add speed, find my particle, add speed, to the point where it accelerates nicely to the middle. The other really nice effect that you can build with scripts is to just basically animate the emitter or the game object controlling the emitter. So in that other example, we've basically just got a spinner acting on our emitter, and because the particles are existing in local space, they're actually forming this nice vortex shape. Finally, shaders. I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but shaders are super awesome. You can play with shaders heaps to get all these different awesome effects. It's also important to pick a good shader at the start. The shader dictates what your material is going to do. So if you need alpha, you want a shader with alpha. If you're dealing with alpha, do you want things to be additive? Do you want things to be multiply? Additive shaders are really nice for a lot of particle effects, especially if you want to start adding sprites over the top of each other. The more they add over, you get this nice like white hot areas in the middle. It also allows you to create different looks and styles, and it completely changes the kind of effect you're working on. Right now, that big puff of fireball smoke is a little shader that I worked on that basically changes the color tone of the mesh depending on which way the light's pointing at it. So it takes the vertex color of the particle system, gives it to the mesh, and then where the shadows fall on the mesh, it changes it. So it bends it from orange to red, which is really nice and interesting, and creates something that's completely stylistic and looks super nice. The other things that are really cool for a lot of particle systems and explosions in games, you'll see this in Battlefield, you'll see this in Fallout 4, is gradient maps. They'll use a lot of gradient maps to change something from orange to red over its lifetime based on what grayscale texture you give it. Happy to talk about that further later. I'm only just starting to experiment and that sort of stuff, and I didn't have enough time to chuck in some core examples of that into here. So, I think I'm just on time. Luckily, I've been answering questions as we go, but maybe we have time for a couple more. Yes?
How do you go about getting your particles into UI, things like a pinata? Do you use like a render texture?
We use render textures for a couple of things. If you're dealing with a 2D game, basically one of the best ways is to have an individual particle camera that's just layered on top of everything if you want things to be appearing on top of things. Otherwise, you can put them in your game where they need to be. Yes?
Do you usually make your PowerPoint presentations in
engine? No. First and maybe only time I'll ever do this. Because there's no other way to show you how particles work or change how they work over the time to give a nice technical demonstration. Any other quick questions? I think we're done. Is that it? Oh, okay. Yes? You can go.
Oh, wait, if you share the presentation with I'll have to find out where I can or can't, because there are assets on there that Mighty Games and Hipster Whale and Disney own. So, giving anything that's source related may be a bit difficult, but what I can do is take screenshots of each individual slide and upload that. Any other questions?
Yeah, my actual question was, have you tried, you mentioned you can't do score like basis to have you tried doing
Yes, I have, by using shaders. So I've started to add deforms into shaders to make fire do this. And that sort of stuff is really cool. Yes, you can. But I'd also like to find out whether or not I can have an actual mesh move on some sort of IK system or something like that and have it then made out of the particle system. Any other quick questions? Yep?
Do you have much in Vertex view?
No, I have no idea what that is. Maybe you can illuminate me later. Okay, any other questions? Thank you very much.